It's audio visual time here at the Backyard Tech Channel. This one, home theater systems. Let's get into it. G'day everyone. Thank you for tuning in. It is audio visual time here at the Backyard Tech Channel, and this one is advice on home theater. Now, I've been receiving some private messages from a viewer who wants to know why I've got my home theater system set up the way I have and what you need for a basic home theater. And I've said this many times before, you don't necessarily need HDMI for the whole thing. As long as you've got a coaxial or optic fiber spit of input into your amplifier, you can actually run just a 5.1 channel surround sound amp just for the audio. Now, he's seen videos of my setup and I've explained it to him in the past. I do know who it is who's been asking me this, so I know it's not a troll. And he's basically asked, why have I got the speakers I've got and why have I not gone for like the cuboid type ones? Now, even though the cuboid and some of the smaller speakers out there do have a dynamic range to match the much heavier and more solid style of speakers that some of us are much more used to, I don't like them from an aesthetics point of view. So I'm going to head upstairs and I'm going to show you why I've got my setup the way I've got it and ideally how your setup should be based upon your lounge room. Now this comes from experience with me as well. I've set systems up many times over the years. Probably undoubtedly I'll be howled on because I haven't followed the rule books or I don't do it according to what everyone else says it should be done. But the way I've done it, and you've got to remember, I've done it for both friends, I've done it for people I've met over the years, and I've done it for a business back in the early 2000s as well. So let's go upstairs and let's have a look at how I've got my system set up and why this is should be what you should start off as your basic surround sound setup. Let's go upstairs.
All right, well, here we are up in my lounge room, my beautiful big Samsung 55-inch TV and my home theater system. Now, look, I'm going to probably get into a world of trouble for saying this. It won't be the first time, it won't be the last time. We all understand the convenience of running everything HDMI, right? It's simple. You plug HDMI from optical media player into amp, and then you plug HDMI from amp up to television. But you don't need to always do that, okay? There is another way of doing it, all right? Currently, the way this thing is set up, I have an optical fiber lead, so SPDIF optical, Sony Philips digital interface optical, running from the optic out on the computer to the SPDIF optical in on the amp. Meaning, if I put a Blu-ray in here in 5.1 channel or whatever, it'll switch the amp automatically and I'll get full Dolby DTS. Now, when you're setting up a basic 5.1 channel surround sound around where your television is, you want your center speaker at your TV, right? Because when you're listening in 5.1 channel surround sound, your voice is going to emanate from this speaker here, the front speaker. That way it's in line with your vision. Then your left and your right should be in the vicinity of your TV unit in surround sound platform, topology, whatever you want to call it, all right? So your front left and your front right should be either side of the television in itself. Now, this doesn't matter whether the TV's on an entertainment unit or my nemesis hung on the wall. Okay, so we sort that problem out. The next problem you want sorted out, though, is your subwoofer. Where should it go? To me, a subwoofer is a 180-degree backflip on what children used to be. Now, back in the 1800s and 1900s and that, at schools and et cetera, children were to be seen but never heard, right? Well, a subwoofer, from my point of view, should be the opposite. A subwoofer should be heard and not seen. Now, my sub is actually in behind here, okay? Now, so what do you do for your rear speakers? Well, let me show you. So depending on your lounge suite, whether you've got a corner lounge suite or just one that runs across, you want the rear speakers, so rear left, rear right, in the vicinity of the couch at ear height. You don't want them below or too far above your seating position, because you want these, especially in a either a 5.1 channel surround sound motion or in an Atmos audio setting, you want these at ear height. You see here, I've got one Yamaha there, that's rear right, one Yamaha here, which is rear left, and they're basically at ear height. All right? Now, let me explain why you want them in ear height. If they're below the level of your couch, the sound's going to get muffled, you're going to get reflection from the couch back out, and you're going to end up with a delay factor that's going to be a little bit uncomfortable, especially in a Atmos-like environment, okay? So, but if they're too high, the sound's going to go straight over the top of you, okay? So you want them basically at the height of your ears or at least at above the height of the couch. Now, there are some houses nowadays where they're putting the surrounds up in the roof. I don't particularly like that idea, because that means the sound's coming down on you and at you, and it can be a little bit off-putting. Okay, so that's the topology of the speakers. So what about the amp? Well, even if you do have an HDMI amp, you'll obviously get surround sound. But if you've got just an older school home theater amp where the only way of getting digital audio in it to get the amp to switch is via coax or optical, you're still going to get digital sound. So if your optical media player has HDMI out as well as either coax out or SPDIF optic out, but your amp's only got coax in or SPDIF optical in, you don't have to run that through this. You can plug video into the HDMI of your television and come out with either optic or SPDIF into your amplifier. You are still going to get 5.1 channel digital surround sound. Okay, for me personally here in my lounge room, you see there I'm running 5-channel stereo. So the center speaker is sort of split left and right. This matches the rears of each of them, and then I've got the sub. Now what I'm going to do for you here, and I can use this piece of music because you guys know I've got it credited. It's Pamgaea from Kevin MacLeod. I do have it credited in my description. So I want you to listen to how I've got my system here sounding. I'll just turn the volume up a bit. Now we'll go to the back speakers. So this is out of the rear left, right, but you can still hear the front sounding as well. Okay, so why do I have these big old Yamaha floor standers instead of getting like little cuboids there? Well, I've got carpet. Carpet enhances bass, especially in a subwoofer, but also woofers as well. Now, these are the Yamahas that we repaired in a video going way back, right? But you can see how beautiful they sound and how beautiful they look. Now, you don't have to match your amp and your speakers. That's a load of rubbish. As long as the impedance, say you've got an 8-ohm speaker and an 8-ohm amp, as long as the impedance and the general wattage is in the vicinity of what the amp wants, then you are able to use whatever speakers you want. You don't have to have a Yamaha amp with Yamaha speakers. You can have a beautiful Pioneer amp with a good set of Wharfdales. Or you can have a Denon amp with a good set of JBLs. You can have a beautiful Marantz amp with a beautiful set of B&Ws, Bowers and Wilkins. Okay? So you don't necessarily need to match everything. Now, I'm obviously not going to put a Blu-ray on here and watch this switch because I'll get into trouble. But because I can get, this is Farron, obviously, as I can get this to switch, the optic in this switches this, if this is detecting 5.1 channel surround sound, this will flip over to DTS. Like that. Without a problem. So if your amplifier doesn't have HDMI and your optical player does, a pretty much basic setup would be to run a coax, get an RCA lead, and just run it as a coax from the optical to the surround sound. But the general basic layout for a simple home theater would be left, right, center, sub at the back to enhance the bass coming forward, and then your two rears. And that's the easiest way to set this up. Now, with 7.1 channel, okay, you end up with two extra speakers at the rear. So you've got two side speakers. At 7.2 channel, the point two is you have an extra sub. So you have a left sub and a right sub. Right? Now there's 7.1, there's 7.2, and then there's 10.2. Now 10.2 is 10 speakers and then two speakers above the television. So as the sound rises up the TV, your audio rises as well. So, what sort of home theater amp should you get based upon your wants and needs? It comes down to how much you want to spend. Now, I'm not a fan of the home theater AIO units where the optical player is actually in the amp. I'm a little bit old school. I think the optical media player should be separate from the amp. It gives you more customization. You can also customize which speakers you end up wanting to get. Right, so when it comes down to brand of amp, we'll get into that shortly. But basically, look, a simple setup for simple 5.1 would be a DTS amplifier or THX, doesn't matter. I'm a Dolby person, so I'm obviously going to go with a Dolby amp, whether it be DTS or AC3, it doesn't matter. Or ProLogic. Nice set of speakers. Make sure your center's at your television. Now, in my case, my center is below my TV, but that's fine because the sound will emanate essentially from the front area, right? Now, if that being the case, a simple 5.1 channel setup would be front, left, front, right, center, sub at the back of the TV if that's possible. If not, put it in a corner somewhere where it's not going to be seen without it biasing the bass towards that corner. Two rears, again, at around ear height, and you'll be right. You'll have a perfectly easy setup home theater.
Right, so what type of home theater amp should you look at? And what brands should you look at? Well, the bare minimum needs to be 5.1 channel. We've had 5.1 channel for at least 20 years. Maybe longer, I can't remember. So if you want to set up a basic home theater audio system, 5.1 channel. Now, what are the point? What's the difference of the numbers either side of that point? Well, the numbers on the left-hand side of the point indicate the number of main speakers, so 5, 6, 7, 10. The numbers after the point indicate the number of subwoofers the system is capable of running, meaning 5.1 channel, 5 speakers, 1 sub. 6.1 channel, again, 6 speakers, 1 sub. 7.1, 7 speakers, 1 sub. However, if you happen to have an amplifier that is, say, 6.2 channel, you have 6 main speakers, 2 subs. And normally in that case, you would set the subs up left and right. All right. Now, So the bare minimum, 5.1 channel. Does it have to be HDMI? Not always, no. If you are on eBay and find an amp that has coax or optical fiber in it, and your optical video player or DVR or set-top box or satellite box has got coax audio out or optical audio out, as well as HDMI, and the amp does not, then you just run an old RCA lead or an optic fiber lead straight out of the source of the audio into the amp. You have then digital audio. There is this thing going around that HDMI audio is better than optical audio or coax audio. It's digital audio. Okay? Let's keep it simple, stupid here. It's digital audio. Right, brands. As I said, I'm not a fan of the AIO systems, so brands vary. Onkyo, Pioneer, Marantz, Denon, Yamaha, Cambridge, some of those. Tivoli makes some very nice ones as well. Bose, Bang & Olufsen. It really comes down to how much you want to spend on an amp. If you want to spend big biggies, then you get the bigger amps, the Macintoshes, etc. The preamps and the valves, boosters and frequency enhancers and all this type of stuff. Does an amp, you know, is Pioneer better than Onkyo? Well, no, Pioneer and Onkyo are the same. Is Marantz better than Onkyo? Comes down to price. Do you have to have Marantz speakers with a Marantz amp? No. There's been this adage out for a long time by both manufacturers and some installers that when you buy Amp X, you have to buy the corresponding speakers to it. I've never had that problem in my entire life setting up home theatres. The basic rule that I have worked on has been as long as the speaker's nominal power is in the same framework as the nominal output coming from the amp in RMS, and that the impedance of the speakers matches the impedance of the amp, then it doesn't matter what brand of speakers you buy. Like I've said, you can have a beautiful Onkyo Black Series amp matched up with a set of Bowen Wilkins speakers, or a set of Wharfdales, or a set of Bose, or a set of Bang & Olufsen BO Labs, or JBLs, Linear Design, whatever you want to say. Who's better? Wharfdale, Bang & Olufsen, Bowen Wilkins, JBL? What? Comes down to price again. So why does Backyard Tech here, why does Old Mate not like the Cuboid speakers? Is it their sound quality? Nope. Is it because they're cubes? Nope. Is it because he's old school? Yes. I'm one of these people who prefer big old floor standing speakers, 2-, 3-, 4-way speakers. Now, we've seen my Dream Acoustics tower speakers I've got here. All right, we've looked at them before. They are beautiful speakers. The sound quality out of them is absolutely phenomenal. Okay. If you can get your hands on a nice set of speakers in the same wattage range and impedance range as your home theater amp, you're not going to have a problem. Now, what about speaker wires? Again, that depends on the power output of the amp and what the speaker manufacturer recommends as a gauge of wire. Now, if the gauge of wire on the speaker matches the gauge of wire required by the amplifier manufacturer, you're right. But as long as you're in the ballpark between the two, you're not going to have degradation. You're not going to have signal degradation or volume degradation, let alone the wires getting hot, Remember, you are sending down alternating current down a speaker wire, so you do generate a small amount of heat. Meaning, you don't want to try and jam 175 watts RMS out of the left channel down a headphone lead. It will get hot. My adage is, get the gauge that suits the speaker manufacturer and the amp and find the happy medium. You'll be right. Now, okay, I mentioned, unsurprisingly, Pioneer Onkyo. Do I have a gold standard of home theater amps? Well, my number one choice normally is Pioneer Onkyo. But it comes down to your budget requirements. It also comes down to, do you really want a home theater amp that is overpowered for your room, whether it's your living room, your family room, your theater room, your cinema room, whatever? Do you really need an amp when you get it to minus 60 dB that's going to blow your ears off? And if you get it up to minus 45 dB logarithmically, that you're going to end up having the cops knocking on your own front door because your neighbors are complaining? A 1 kilowatt RMS power amp in a small lounge room is a bit of overkill. Now, people would say, no, it's not, backyard. You know, the more audio power that comes out of it, the better the amp is. Sure, great. But if you're running a logarithmic amp, regardless of whether the volume scale is running logarithmically or linearly, or VU for that volume unit scale, you're going to blow your ears off if you run the amp at minus 30 dB in a small room. You're going to blow the living hell out of your ears and you're not going to enjoy yourself. My rule of thumb has always been, work out the size of the room, then have a chat to the company you're looking at buying the amp from, and then buy the amp from the retail store. That's been my rule of thumb for a long time. Now, what do I think about buying secondhand amps on eBay? Well, I've had secondhand amps before. My Yamaha down under here is the first new amp I've ever had. And frankly, I haven't had a problem with it. I would rather have had a Pioneer, yeah, sure. Or an Onkyo or a Marantz, yeah, sure. But the Pioneer is matched to my speakers. The nominal wattage and impedance is within the ballpark of Yamaha's requirements. It works. And it works beautifully. So there we go. Home theater advice for those. As I said, if you're just starting out and you're going to build your own home theater, now, I know I'm going to get yelled at because I have not mentioned soundbars, mainly because I'm looking at home theater from the traditional sense, not from the contemporary sense, okay? So, if you're looking at doing it on the cheap, go and get a soundbar. But if you want true home theater, start out with a 5.1 channel, and it'll get you through anything. Blu-ray, DVD, TV, DVR, your satellite box, your, excuse me, your cable box, whatever. Most cable boxes here in Australia have still got coax out. Not necessarily optic out, but coax digital out too. And remembering that coax digital also can fall under SPDIF, Sony Philips Digital Interface, for audio. So there's some home theatre advice for those. I'm hoping the guy that's been asking me to do this video actually watches it very soon. Stick around. We've got more coming up throughout the day here at the Backyard Tech Channel. Until then, as always, we shall catch you in the next video. Thank you very much for watching. Please like, comment, and subscribe. Cheers.